Hey everyone, I'm Anish and welcome back to Prefusion. So today we'll be starting the lecture 5 of Nike Sprout. So before the lecture starting the main topic, I want to conclude what happened in the previous lecture. And one thing I want to tell you is that basically I told you right in the previous lecture that you can simply just draw one straight line and check how many cuts are there, right? How many cuts are there, and from that you can find the value of n, that is the number of instruments. But what I understood later on is that it may cause, that is one method also, okay, but understood that it may cause a bit of confusion, because if there is some other instruments which is not around this -1,0, which is here, let's say, then you will be confused that whether you should pass this line through here or here, right? So yeah, what you do, I will tell you when we will solve question how to find the number of instruments, and there you will see. So that is one thing I wanted to tell you, that method is obviously valid, but you won't be able to understand when to take this straight line here and when to take this straight line here, okay? For that, simply how to find the number of instruments in this plot, this is the -1,0 point. What I can see, that this is completing, okay, one loop, and also this is also completing another loop, right? What is a loop? The loop is from where I start, I should end, right? So I'm starting from here and I'm ending here. I'm starting from here and I'm ending here, right? Okay, I'm going through the plot. So yeah, then I have what, two instruments which is in the clockwise direction, but what was my Nike's contour? Nike's contour was in the clockwise direction itself, right? Nike's contour was also in the clockwise direction. Then what does that mean? That means my n equals to -2, because what I was expecting, number of instruments in the anti-clockwise direction. If I have two instruments in the clockwise direction, that means I have two instruments in the anti-clockwise direction, okay? That is the simple meaning, right? So if I have something opposite of that, then I have negative of that, right? That is the simple meaning. So yeah, n here is minus. So we'll solve many questions, right? And from there we'll understand the concept basically. So let's start our lecture. So I will start with the conclusion of Nike's stability criterion, right? So even if you couldn't understand the previous lecture, right, or if you couldn't understand the bit of theory, just listen to me very carefully here. This point is very important, and this is what from this mainly the questions will get asked in the exam, okay? Very important. So mainly, in which plane I plot my Nike's plot? I plot my Nike's plot in mainly g of h of s plane, right? G of h of s plane, not in the 1 plus g of h of s plane, right? Not in the 1 plus g of h of s plane. Why? I will explain you, right? So I want to write here. We obviously can plot in other planes also, 1 plus g of s plane also, but that is just a simple convention. That's why, not anything that there's some rule or something. No, this is a simple convention that we have been following, okay? G of H of S plane. Okay, so this is the first thing, and in the G of H of S plane we have two critical points. One is the 0,0, one is the -1,0. But sir, you said the critical point was -1,0. Why did 0,0 come? So sometimes the question won't be straightforward to you, right? Question will be twisted, and when the twisted question comes, then this 0,0 also becomes a critical point. So these two points are my critical points. These two points are critical points, right? So why are these two points critical? Let's first understand why is the origin critical point. So from mapping theorem, what was the rule or the principal argument? What was the rule basically? What was the conclusion that we found out? We found out that the encirclement around origin will be equals to my number of poles minus number of zeros. If I write it as P minus Z, total number of encirclements around origin, if I write it as P minus Z, that means it will be in the opposite direction of contour. If I write it as Z minus P, it will be the value, like n will be in the same, the whichever number of encirclements I get, that direction of the number of encirclements will be in the same direction as that of the previous contour. So zeros don't change the direction, poles change the direction, right? That's why if I write P here first, then yeah, my direction has changed. So, and if I write Z first, my direction will not change, okay? So all those things we have explained in details in the previous lectures. So here, number of encirclement around origin of G of S, H of S plane in like, what does this N00 represent? N00 represents the number of encirclement around origin of G of S, H of S plane, this plane, right? Of this plane and the origin in opposite direction of Nyquist contour. This is simple N, okay? We know, like, this is representing the number of encirclements around the origin, right? In the G of S, H of S plane. Now, what is this POL plus representing? POL plus is representing the number of poles of G of S, H of S on the right hand side of the S plane, basically. So this is the number of poles of G of S, H of S, okay? Just keep this in mind. This is number of poles of G of S, H of S, and not 1 plus G of S, H of S, right? Okay, but still they are same, okay? As I have derived earlier, because the denominator, this of 1 plus G of S, H of S, remains same, right? Denominator is same, so this will be same. I will explain further. So this, like, when you are finding the encirclements around origin, then the poles of that mapped function, this is the map function, right? f of s should be here, and the zeros of that map function should be here, right? That was the basic definition, like when we were finding encirclements and origin. That's what we did in mapping theorem. So POL is this. And what is my contour? What is my mapped contour? Map contour is the whole right hand side. That's why this is plus, because I'm covering the whole right hand side of the S plane, okay? I hope you remember the map contour, basically, okay? That's why. And what is my ZOL plus? ZOL plus is the number of zeros of G of S, H of S on the right hand side of the S plane, basically, of the S plane, okay? Why? Because my map contour is on the covering the whole right hand side. I'm interested in the right hand side. That's why my map contour is like that. So this is what my N00 and POL plus and ZOL plus is, okay? So very simple, right? So this is one point. So N00 is this, okay? Now what is the second point? The second point that I explained in the previous lecture, the encirclements, number of encirclements in the minus 1,0 point, okay, and in the G of H of S plane, not on the 1 plus G of H of S plane, in the G of H of S plane, which will be obviously in the opposite direction of the Nyquist contour, because my formula is P minus Z. Now what is this P plus 1 plus OL? What is this P plus 1 plus OL? This P plus 1 plus OL is the number of poles of 1 plus G of S, H of S on the right hand side of the S plane. Why? Because I told you, right, we can, we basically G of S, H of S and 1 plus, if I want to go from 1 plus G of H of S to G of H of S, what I need to do? I need to left shift every point by minus 1. So the origin of 1 plus G of S is basically the minus 1,0 point of this G of H of S plane, okay? So all those things I have explained, I'm just revising you. If you couldn't understand, if you couldn't grasp, you have to go back to the notes and see, right, what I have written. So that's why if I want to find the right hand side poles of this 1 plus OL, 1 plus G of H of S, right, then I just need to find the number of encirclements on the what? On the G of H of S point on the minus 1,0 point. Now you say me, sir, why are we doing this much? Just draw the 1 plus G of H of S plane and find the number of encirclements and the origin, and that's it. But you know, engineers like to make few things tough, and what happens is we like are very lazy, so we want to get all the information from this plane only. We don't want to draw another plane. That is so much of task. So that's why we want to get all the information from OLTF. That's why, so that we can say that I'm getting all the information from OLTF, not from this characteristic equation, right? I want to get all the information from OLTF. That's why it's just that, like that only. So they want to get all the information from here. That's why we have to learn this much, right? So basically, now this is the number of poles of 1 plus G of S on the right hand side of S plane. So what is the poles of 1 plus G of HFS? The poles are same as this POL plus, basically the open loop poles, right? So like this is already derived. So this is same as the open loop poles, okay? And what is this open loop poles? Like open loop poles is represented as P. Whenever you are confused, right, you write like this, right? you represent your p as z, because you will get confused with pz, because there will be so many pz's and you will get confused. You write n as this, you write p as this, right? So that no confusion occurs and you don't make any silly errors in the exam, right? So yeah, this is pol plus. Now what is z plus 1 plus ol? It is number of zeros of 1 plus g of h of s plane on the right hand side of 1 plus g of h of s on the right hand side of s plane. Okay, so what do we represent by number of zeros? What do we represent by zeros of 1 plus g of s? If you remember, right, it was n naught of s plus d naught of s. Now n naught of s plus d naught of s also represented by closed loop poles. So open loop like the zeros of 1 plus g of s of s represent the closed loop poles also. So this will represent my closed loop poles, right? So this is my basically closed loop poles. These are no notation. So this is what I am interested in. I want to find my z plus y. So this is the main focus of attention. Okay. If I have any other. This is the main focus of attention. This is very important. This is what we need to find out, right? But obviously, you like simply from the, if they give you the diagram, you can simply find the n, okay, number of n segments around the minus 1, 0 point. And it, like from the OLTV, you can find p plus, okay? From the OLTV, you can find p plus because the poles are OLTV and these are same, okay? And you'll find z plus. Now, what happens is that gate wants to play a bit of game with you. So obviously, they won't that easily give you this p plus. They want you to use this formula as well. So what they will do, these are same, so gate says that these are same, so what's the point of even giving this, right? He will only use this formula, he won't use this formula. They will tell you to, they will give you this, right, z over plus the open loop zeros. Okay, these are basically my what, open loop zeros. On right hand side, okay. Right hand side, okay. So yeah, they will give you this, and from here, in that same diagram, you will find number of n segments on the origin, and you will find the POL plus. Now, if you get the POL plus, then you go to here, right? So basically, from like that's the most difficult question of Nyquist will come. It's the maximum, right? Maximum limit. This is so. Basically what you will do, they will give you zol plus, okay, then you will find pol plus, and n already you can find from the diagram, okay, this already from diagram, right? From diagram, okay. So yeah, this you find from the diagram, and like from zol you find pol plus, and pol plus you put here, right? And from pol plus you go to z plus, right? This is the basically sequence of Nyquist. Now it may so happen that the sequence of operations may change, right? That may happen, right? But I'm just telling you the convention, what conventionally what will get asked to you. Okay, this is the convention. Now out of the box something may also get asked, right? But this is what you need to follow. So now, how to solve Nyquist problems basically. So basically, there are two types, right? If your Nyquist plot is given, if Nyquist plot is not given, okay? Now, if Nyquist plot is not given, sorry, if Nyquist plot is given, right? Then obviously, you find the stability directly from the plot, directly from these formulas, right? Directly from these formulas. But if your Nyquist plot is not given, if your Nyquist plot is not given, then you can find the stability through the Routh Hurwitz criteria, or you draw the Nyquist plot. But I will recommend this one. Okay, you check which is consuming you less time, right? Like let's say you have been given a transfer function, and they have told you to find the number of n segments around the minus 1 comma. You have been given the OLTF, and they have told you to find the number of n segments around the minus 1 comma 0 point of the g of s of s plane. Okay, and also they have given you the Nyquist contour. Okay, so what you will do, you can do trick, right? I will, like, when we will solve questions, I will show you how to do that. Basically, either you plot the Nyquist plot, and like from there obviously they have told you to find the n segments, and you see how many n segments are there around that critical point. Or what you can do, you can find the Routh Hurwitz, like you write the route service table, then you find the number of routes that are number of poles around the right hand side of the S plane, okay, using the route service, and the number of poles that are on the right hand side of the S plane will be here Z plus P plus OL. Already you can find out from the OL table itself, you can find N, right? You put P minus Z, you can find N. So you can, you are going back calculation now. You are going back calculation. Now you know the Z plus, you know the P plus, and you have to find the N without the diagram. Okay, like that also you can do. Obviously when we will solve questions you will understand, but first let us obviously draw a few Nyquist plot, because we haven't done that yet, right? So let's draw the Nyquist plot like we have done for one question. So just pause the video. I think in the previous lecture also I have shown this question. So just pause the video, or I haven't, maybe I don't remember. So just pause the video and try to plot the Nyquist plot for all this, and take the Nyquist contour accordingly, whatever I told, right? Like you have to avoid the contour touching the poles, right hand poles, right? Or the poles on the imaginary axis, right? Okay, that you have to avoid, and take Nyquist contour accordingly in the clockwise direction, and plot the Nyquist plot for each of these, right? For each of these, you try to do this by yourself, then you see my solution. Okay, so basically for the first one, right? For the first one, what will be my Nyquist contour basically? Nyquist contour in this case, right? I don't have any poles at the origin or poles at the imaginary axis, right? Conjugate imaginary poles. Okay, I don't have any. So basically, okay, so basically, right, what will be my Nyquist contour? Nyquist contour will be very simple. Okay, basically a semicircle, like it will cover the whole imaginary axis, okay, and infinite radius, right? Basically this will go from omega equals to 0 plus to omega equals to 0 plus, right? Again, like what will happen, like this is in the clockwise direction, right? This is in the clockwise direction, and like what is the plane? It is very important to write the plane, right? In which plane we are in? We are in the S plane, because we are checking for all the right hand poles and zeros of like the old tape. So S plane we are in. So this is basically okay, real of S and imaginary of S, right? So and this, oh no, this radii is of infinity, right? This radii is of infinity. So like now again, right, this radius, you know, now again here, this is, this point is basically omega equals to minus infinity, like infinity minus is, it's like basically minus infinity, so this is 0 minus, right? They are almost stretching. Okay, so how many curves do I have, right? Basically I have this first curve, right? Then this whole curve, okay, then again this curve. Okay, so I have three curves. This is in the clockwise direction. Okay, three curves I have, right? So we will do the curve 1 and 2 together, right? Basically that's the steps, right? Basically that steps will follow. So curve 1 is basically 0 omega to infinity, right? 0 plus to infinity plus. Okay, And what is curve 2? Curve, it's not curve 2. Curve 3, I will name this, right? What is curve 3? Curve 3 is simply omega minus 2, 0 minus, okay? So these two will do same because we wrote the key point, right? Basically, these two are mirror images, right, of each other. So basically, what is my transfer function? It's very simple, right? Transfer function is 1 plus s tau. So like, we just put omega equals to, like, put this equals to g of g omega, okay? So I will not, like, waste much time in this, right? So at omega equals to 0, what is happening? So we'll draw this plane, okay, in rough, basically. Okay, I'll just draw this in rough. Imagine you have g of h of s. Okay, so this is my real and imaginary of g of h of s, right? So now basically you put omega equals 0, you're getting 1, right? So I will just reduce the size of this. So we're getting 1 here, right? So like 1, and what is happening? The angle is decreasing, but the magnitude is decreasing. Obviously, if we increase omega, what it is in denominator, right? So angle will decrease. So I will not derive this right now. So it will be something like this. It will go to 0, right? It will go to 0 basically. So this is my basically omega equals to 0 plus 2. Okay, I needed to copy this plane. I will copy this because this is very important. Copy and paste this here because I will need this multiple times. Okay, fine. Now, right, I will paste this. Okay, not here. Now basically what will be my mirror image, basically my mirror image, right? Mirror image will be something like this. Okay, this was omega equals to 0 plus, and this was omega equals to infinity. Okay, so this one is the mirror image. Okay, I won't think anything, I'll just draw the mirror image. So this point will be omega equals to infinity plus, this point will be omega equals to 0 plus, 0 minus. Okay, sorry, not 0, infinity plus, this is 0, infinity minus. Okay, so like when you are obviously totally accustomed with this concept, right? So you will draw this directly, we will not draw this by parts, right? Draw this directly. Okay, so now what about my curve 2 basically? No, what about the curve? 2. So what is happening in the curve 2 basically? So in the curve 2, right? In the curve 2 basically, what is happening? I have a semicircle of infinite radius. So basically it is going from pi by 2 to minus pi by 2. So here s is equals to what? R e raised to power j theta. It is a circle basically, that's why we represent it like this one, right? So whenever it is a circle, whenever polar plot, when was it a spiral like circle like structure? It was when s equals to r, it was j omega. And here obviously s equals to j omega, and here also s equals to j omega, right? So, and here what is r going to? R is going to infinity, right? And theta is going from plus pi by 2 to minus pi by 2, that is in the clockwise direction, right? So I'll just reduce the size of this. Okay, So yeah, this is what my theta is going to. So what about my curve 2 basically? What about my curve 2? Okay, so my curve 2, right? Curve 2 basically is s equals to, I will put s equals to r e to the power j omega. So my g of s, h of s will become 1 by 1 plus r e raised to the power j theta, not omega, sorry. And limit as r tending to infinity. So if r is tending to infinity, what will happen? This one will get ignored, right? One we can ignore. Okay, so this becomes 1 by r e raised to power j theta, or I can write theta in the numerator also, minus j theta . So basically, if limit r tending to infinity, right, then 1 by r, it tends to 0. And what happens to minus theta? So theta, my theta is varying from 90 to minus 90. So what will happen to minus theta? Minus theta will vary simply from minus 90 to plus 90. Just negation, right? Negation. So basically, how many semicircles we get? We get one semicircle of almost zero radius. Radius is zero because the magnitude is zero, right? And we're rotating one half cycle. In what direction? In anti-clockwise direction, because this is going from negative to positive. So I can write over here, can reduce the size of all this, right? We are getting basically one semicircle of zero radius. We are getting one semicircle of zero radius in the anticlockwise direction, right? In the anticlockwise direction. Okay, so this is what we are getting. So this also we can write as, right, this also we can write as POL minus ZOL. Okay, basically number of poles of the OLTF minus number of zeros of the OLTF. Basically that represents my number of encirclements around the origin, right? That's why. Okay, basically here, number of half circles around the origin. Okay, this represents my number of half circles around the origin, number of half circles. Okay, so here we had one half circle, right? And P is 1 and Z is 0. Okay, we don't have any zeros, right hand zeros, and we don't have any, like, basically this is not about the right hand zeros. Okay, this is the number of poles and number of zeros. Okay, so let me explain. Not like I explained, right? Okay, let me just explain the previous case also. Like, if I have written the short points, number of open loop poles minus open loop zeros, just remember this, right? This is not right hand zeros, don't get confused by that. Basically simply number of open loop poles minus open loop zeros. Okay, no, nothing related with this, just keep that in mind. Simple number of open loop poles minus open loop zeros. Okay, just keep that in mind. So POL minus ZOL, like here, how many poles we have? One, and zeros as 0, right? So it becomes 1 minus 0 as 1. Okay, like, why is this the case? Because what is happening basically, when r is going to infinity, right, then the other part is getting like checked out, and we remained with only the dominating part. So pole and zero are directly in effect, right? Here the angle will be directly in effect with the cancellation of pole and zero. That's why. Okay, so yeah, this is the case for the curve 2 basically, and this will be my plot basically. I won't explain this further. Basically this is the mirror image, right? And this is going in the this anti-clockwise direction. This is always in the right hand side, right? And here, right, we also have a half semicircle from where it is going from minus pi by 2 to pi by 2, right? minus pi by 2 to pi by 2 or minus 90 to 90. Okay, so this is basically like this point, right? This point is my starting point, omega equals to this is omega equals to 0 plus this omega equals to infinity plus this omega equals to infinity minus. Okay, 0 minus, right? So yeah, this is basically how my plot will look like, right? So now go to the next question basically. So before going to the next question, I just want to copy a few plots here. Okay, I need 3 I think in this. So let me copy the question. So this was the question. I have a pole at the origin. So the type of the system is 1. Previously my type of system was 0. That's why we didn't have any infinite semicircle, right? So you, like, once you are pro at this, you will solve this directly now. Okay, so this is my g of s of s, right? So I'll put s equals to j omega now, but before that obviously I need the contour. So okay, I need the contour, so I will use this as contour itself, right? Get this one. No, not this one. If I use this one as contour. Okay, so basically, right, this is the real and imaginary part of sigma plus j omega plane basically. So this is j omega sigma plane, or you can say real part of s and imaginary part of s. Now how will I choose my contour this time, right? I have a pole at the s equals to 0. Okay, at the origin I have a pole, so obviously I will avoid the origin. So my contour will look something like this. It will start from like here, and then I will avoid the origin, then again I will go, okay, and then we cover the entire right up plane. Okay, so yeah, this is this case, and this is this one, right? This is this one. Okay, so like this is, you can see it is in the anti-clockwise, but this is in the clockwise. Just keep that in mind, right? And here, like, my radius will be obviously infinity. Okay, my radius will be infinity. Okay, and like, what is happening between each point? So let's mark points, right? So basically we are moving here, omega goes to 0 plus, to here omega goes to infinity plus. Now what is happening at this point? My r is here, right? Here s equals to j omega. At this region, in this region also s equals to j omega. Okay, but in this region, okay, in this region my s is equals to r e raised to power j theta, because it is like a circle like structure, right? So if my s is equals to this one, then my r is tending to infinity and theta is going from pi by 2 to minus pi by 2. Okay, now what is happening here? Like, for finding the theta, it is very important, but like, you can remember all this, right? Or like, you don't have to draw the Nikes contour all the time. I'm drawing it, just this is a starting point, that's why, right? So again, what about this region, right? What about this region? For this region, obviously my s is equals to r e raised to power j theta, but this time, right, my r is tending to infinity and theta is going from minus minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Theta is going from minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2, right? So this is what my theta is going to. Okay, so yeah, this is the Nyquist contour basically. So did I write the heading previously? Yeah, let's just copy the heading. Okay, let's just copy here. Okay. Okay, this is basically my Nyquist contour, right? So now let's do it for like curve 1 and curve 2. Again, the same thing, right? Same thing. Okay, I'll just copy this one. Curve 1 and curve 2, right? This is a step you follow, basically. This is to... So what will the plot like? Polar plot, basically you have to plot the polar plot, right? So if you remember that at s equals omega equals to 0, like this will be replaced by s equals to j omega. So this will become simply 1 by j omega plus 2, right? So 1 by j omega plus 2 basically. So if you put omega equals to 0, what happens? This blows up, goes to infinity. And what is the angle? Angle is basically, this doesn't contribute to any angle. This contribute to what? Minus 90 angle, right? Minus 90. So doing this directly now. So my polar plot will look something like this, right? And what will my Nyquist? Like this is the point. Omega equals 0 plus. And this is the point at omega goes to infinity plus, right? So what will my Nyquist plot basically? What will my inverse polar plot? Mirror image of this one, right? So it will be something like this. Magnitude is reducing. Okay, always. That is already understood. Okay. So yeah, basically this point. This point is omega 0 minus this point is equal to omega to infinity minus, right? This point is equal to omega to infinity minus. Okay, so yeah, so it's just too much tired and enough sleep actually. Okay, so omega equals to 0 minus, and this is infinity minus. This is the inverse polar plot and the polar plot, right? So now let's do the curve 2 basically. I'll just copy this one, curve 2, right? Where my r is going to infinity, okay, and my angle is going from plus pi by 2 to minus pi by 2. Maybe I have to sleep after this. My eyes are just getting drained right now. Don't know what happens all of a sudden. Okay, so this is the curve 2 basically. If this is the curve 2, right, my r is going to infinity and obviously my s is r e to j theta, that is already written. So I will copy this transfer function here, right? Copy this. Okay, simply just copy this. If I just copy this, what will happen? So this will become limit is r tending to infinity, okay, 1 by r e raised to power j theta or e raised to power j theta plus 2. Okay, so this is what my g of s of s is. Now if r is tending to infinity, what will happen? Obviously we'll ignore this previous one, so this will become r square and e raised to about 2 theta, it will become, and it will go in the numerator, so it is about minus 2 theta, right? So minus j 2 theta, right? So basically what will happen, so we don't even need to draw this, right? We will draw this in the final diagram itself. So basically what will happen, basically what we'll get is like is almost equal to 0. And what about with theta? Like theta is going from this -90 to -90, then -2 theta, right? Where are the all the colors? This -2 theta will go from -180 to 180 degrees, right? -2 theta will go from -180 to 180 degrees. Okay, so this is what my -2 theta is. So yeah, so like how many half circles will I get? I will get, I will not draw it here. Can I write it here? What I can do is simply take this to the side, take this to the side, take this to this. Okay, yeah, so I will get what, how much total angle is it covering? Is it it is covering one half circle covers -180, one half circle covers 180 degrees, this is covering 360. So I'll get two half circles, two semicircles in anti-clockwise direction, because this is going from -180 to +180. Okay, previously because it was in the clockwise direction. So two half circles anti-clockwise direction. Now okay, if my number of open loop zeros is more than number of open loop poles, that will never happen. That will never happen, right? Because for a consistent system and a proper, for a proper transfer function, if the number of like number of poles has to be greater than the number of zeros. Now my number of poles, as my number of poles will always be greater than number of zeros, then what will happen? Then always at the numerator, right, I will get some negative angle, negative theta. So if it is negative theta, then obviously the direction will change from clockwise to anti-clockwise. This is clockwise, change to anti-clockwise. So this will be always in the anti-clockwise direction. So I can write here, this will be like in the previous short note, right, in the anti-clockwise direction. If I can find it somewhere, where was it? Okay, it was somewhere, right? Just found it. Just hold on a second. Here. So yeah, this will be always in the anti-clockwise direction, or you can say opposite to the Nyquist contour. Okay, or what you can say is, this is very important, right? Very important. This one will be opposite direction to the Nyquist contour, basically opposite direction to the Nyquist contour. Okay, so just keep that in mind. Always, it will be always the case. And for like this case, right, this will be always in the clockwise direction. Okay, basically why, this will be in the same direction as the the type of the system, right? Sorry, this is same direction in the Nyquist plot, basically. Okay, that also I will explain when we'll do the example. Okay, because why in the clockwise? Because at that case, right, in here, what is happening? My Nyquist contour itself is in the anti-clockwise direction. That's why this is in the clockwise direction always. Okay, so yeah, this is also in the opposite direction of my Nyquist contour, but my Nyquist contour itself is in the anti-clockwise direction. Do you remember? This is in the anti-clockwise direction, not in the clockwise. Anti-clockwise. That's why, right? Okay, so yeah, that was the basically conclusion of both of these. Both of them are opposite because obviously it is coming in the denominator itself, right? The angle is coming in the denominator here. Type, I'll just show you when you solve the question. Yeah, this has got two obstacles on the anti-clockwise direction. So this is done again, right? If you just simply do open loop poles minus open loop zeros, you will get the same thing, right? Open loop poles minus open loop zeros. So POL minus ZOL, open loop poles minus open loop zeros, right? Simple open loop poles minus open loop zeros. Zeros, right? Okay, so like we have what, two poles and non-zero, so 2 minus 0 is 0, so two half circles. Okay, and direction will be anti-clockwise. That is fixed, right? So simple. Now what about my curve 4? Basically, I'll just copy this one and change the few things. curve 4. My theta this time is going from minus 90 to plus 90. So this is in the anti-clockwise direction. That's why the direction changes, right? So this is in the anti-clockwise direction. So so basically my r is turning to 0. So theta is going from minus pi by 2 to, sorry, r is turning to 0. Then what will my transfer function become? Again, right, my g of h of s simply will become limit as r tends to 0, 1 by r e raised to power j theta into 1 plus r e raised to power j theta. Okay, obviously this will only get remain, this one will get ignored because 1 will be dominating as r is tending to 0, right? So this one, j theta, so basically it as limit r tend to 0 1 by r, this is tending to infinity, this tend to infinity. So if this tend to infinity, what does this mean? What does this mean? So this means basically my theta, right? Obviously theta will be minus, so if I make the theta in the numerator, right, okay, if I make the theta in the numerator, what will happen? Theta will be like, again sign will change, it will go from plus 90 to minus 90 clockwise direction, right? Clockwise direction, okay, clockwise direction, right? So like how many, like this, right, I will get one, like this is covering total 180 degrees, so I will get one circle of infinite radius, no sorry, one semicircle of infinite radius, right? Let's reduce the size a bit. Circle of infinite radius, one size circle of infinite radius, right? So this is equals to basically what type of the system, okay, type of system or OLTF, type is defined for OLTF only, right? So yeah, this you can do. Okay, so how will the polar plot look like? So the, sorry, how will the Nyquist plot look like? Nyquist plot will look something like this. So obviously we have one semicircle of zero radius and, okay, so this will be a bit wrong, this was two, right, two half circle. Yeah, basically what is happening, this is covering one half circle and this is covering one half circle almost, right? So this is one complete circle and this is one half circle of infinite radius, right? This one half circle of infinite radius. Okay, just let me turn on the this notification. Yeah, okay, is it recording? Yeah, this is recording, I think it's recording, right? Oh no, my mic wasn't recording, shit. This mic wasn't recording. Oh no, that will be bad for me. I have to check. So yeah, we have to deal with it, right? So basically this, right, so from where this is starting, this is starting from omega equals to 0 plus, okay, and here this is ending at omega equals to infinity plus, and this is ending at omega equals to infinity minus, and this is ending at omega equals to 0 minus, right? And this is obviously in the clockwise direction, okay, obviously in the clockwise direction, okay, it is in, it is going like this, right? This is the anti-clockwise direction, right? So, and this is in the clockwise direction, okay? So yeah, am I correct here? Yeah, in the clockwise direction, and on the one in the anti-clockwise direction, right? In the anti-clockwise direction, yeah. So zero radius, this is going in the anti-clockwise direction, and this is in the clockwise direction. Okay, so So from here, can you tell me, is the system stable or not? Can you tell me if the system is stable or not? What you can see is that is it, this is the G of H over spin, is it encircling my critical point, minus 1, 0? It is, isn't right? So N is equals to 0. What about P? Do I have any right hand open loop holes? No, right? I don't have any right hand open loop holes. P is also 0. So N 0, P 0. So Z will also be 0. So from here we can conclude the system will be stable just by looking at this plot. Okay, so that's why, like, in computers, if you plot this, right, simply we can directly from here we can check for the stability. Okay, whichever, like, if the, even if the order is higher, still we can check for the stability. Okay, just by simply plotting it. So yeah, what I want you to do is, okay, we have this last one, right? So I will give you the last one as homework, and I will only do this one, right? This one I won't solve. Okay, so just copy this one. So again, right, what will be the Nyquist contour? So simply I will copy this, right? Nyquist contour will be here. This time obviously we will avoid the origin basically, so it will be same as this one, same as this one. We'll avoid the origin because I have two poles at the origin, right? Two poles at the origin. Okay, we don't have enough space. Why we don't have enough space? That is very disheartening for me to see. Okay, oh no, I copied it at the wrong place, sorry. Yeah, now we have enough space, right? So this is our Nyquist contour. Nothing to explain here. Basically, we will be avoiding the origin itself, right? So this is my Nyquist contour again, right? The curves will be same. Again, I will do the curve 1 and 2, right? Curve 1 and 2. In curve 1 and 2, something will be different this time. Okay, we don't even have to draw this. We don't have to draw this. Oh, actually, we have to. Sorry, we have to draw this. So, this is G of S, H of S, right? Okay. So this is curve 1 and curve 2. So, like, what is my G of H of S? So G of H of S is basically what? It's basically 1, 2 by S square, and S square is G omega. So what happens? What happens? S square becomes minus omega square, right? Minus 2 by omega square. So, like, phase is constant, always negative, right? Always negative. Real number, always negative. Okay, simple. And omega square, what is happening? It is going towards zero. Phase is always constant. So imaginary part is what? Always zero here. So only real part is here, right? Real part is here, which is starting from infinity and going to zero. Imaginary part is constant. Just to show you the there are two plots here. I will draw it like this, but just remember, they are, both of them are overlapping because the imaginary part is zero. From here you can see only the real component is present, right? So this should show you the difference. Like, let's say I'm starting with omega equals to 0 plus. When starting with omega 0 plus, what will happen? It will be something like this, and like they are obviously covering, they are overlapping the imaginary axis itself. Just to show you the difference, I'm drawing it like this. Okay, just to show you the difference. Okay, this is omega equals to 0. Let's say this is omega 0 minus, no, not 0 minus, sorry. This is infinity minus and this is omega equals 0 minus and this is omega equals to 0 plus and this is omega equals to 0 plus it. Okay, this is this case. Now this is my polar and inverse polar plot, basically mirror image, right? Now how many number of half circles now, right? I will calculate this directly. How many number of open loop poles I have? 2. How many number zeros, open loop zeros I have? 0. So number of half circles I will directly calculate. Okay, number of half circles or number of semicircles, right? Number of what infinite radius, sorry, zero radius semicircle. Zero radius semicircle. Why? Because r is tending to infinity. If r is tending to infinity, 1 by r will go to 0. Okay. Okay, number of infinite radius semicircle. So basically what is happening? Right? So in the clockwise direction, obviously. No, sorry, not in the clockwise, in the anti-clockwise direction, in the opposite direction, right? And from where it will start, we'll see, right? How many number of poles we have? P minus Z, okay? So basically, this is equals to 2, right? So 2, so what will happen to minus 2 theta? Minus 2, this is how you solve an exam, right? Minus 2 theta, obviously, theta is going from where? From pi by 2 to minus pi by 2, right? Minus pi by 2. So minus 2 theta will go from where? From minus pi to plus pi, minus pi to plus pi, okay? So this is where my minus 2 theta will go, right? Minus 2 theta will go. Okay, so yeah, this PUL minus Z, all right. So I will get two semicircles, right, of infinite radius. Okay, now what about my curve 3 basically? Curve 3 is about the type, right? Curve 4. So type of the system is equal to 2, right? So I will get 2 semicircles of 0 radius, okay, in the what? In the clockwise direction, okay. And what about my theta? Again, right, there how was my theta varying? My theta was varying like this, right? Minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. So here 2 theta will vary from plus pi to minus pi, right? Plus pi to minus pi. Okay. So 2 theta will vary like this, right? 2 theta will vary like this. So what is happening? Basically, I will get 2 semicircles of 0 radius in the clockwise direction. So if I just draw the plot, right, you will get, this is covering one complete circle, right, and this is the basically the polar part and the inverse polar part, and again, right, I get 2 half circles of infinite radius, right, in the clockwise direction, right, in the clockwise direction, like this here, right, 2 semicircles, I was in sleep actually. Here, right, my r was tending to infinity, so this will go to 0 radius. If you forget sometimes, right, in the exam hall, what you do, you just write r tends to infinity and theta from how theta is varying, so you can directly solve. You don't need to write the transformation, all those things, right? So yeah, sometimes we also get confused with that. So r is tending to infinity here, that's why 1 by r square will go to 0. Like that, you remember, right? Here what is happening? R is tending to 0 here, hence 1 by r will go to infinity. Okay, 1 by r will go to infinity. Just keep this in mind so that you don't make this mistake. Okay, so yeah, this is about this one, right? So like, how is it starting? Like, let's name this as few points, right? We can name this anything. So let's name this as omega equals to 0 plus, like previously I named that, okay, I will name that only. That's right. And yeah, this is how it is varying basically, okay? Here my r is 0 and here my r is infinity. That's why like they are getting inverse of this one, and I hope you understand the plane. Okay, so yeah, this is basically it for this question, and the next question I will just solve this basic. You just use the basic simple Nyquist contour because there isn't any poles at the origin, right? So yeah, I will see you in the next lecture with more questions, and we are almost finished with our this Nyquist chapter, and next we'll start with the Bode plot chapter. So yeah, thank you for watching, and I will see you in the next video.